This tutorial aims to walk you through Lab 17. So in Lab 17 looks at white blood cell counts, both total and what are called differential. So in this case, we're going to do what's called a total white blood cell count, and we're going to approximate a differential white blood cell count. White blood cells comprise the immune system. The typical white blood cell count is somewhere between 4,000 and 11,000 white blood cells per microliter or per millimeter cubed. And so when you get deviations from that, that indicates something is wrong. So for instance, if your white blood cell counts are significantly below 4,000, that suggests that you're immunosuppressed for some reason. I mentioned in Lab 17 that the very first time I taught physiology was actually when I was defending my PhD thesis, and I was stressed beyond belief. And when the students used my blood for a white blood cell count, they said that the number of white blood cells I had was maybe like 1,500 per microliter. So obviously, very immunosuppressed, extreme amounts of stress will cause immunosuppression. On the converse, we have white blood cell counts that are too high. If white blood cell counts are too high, that indicates an infection or that your immune system is overloaded. Sometimes it's useful to look at what's called a differential white blood cell count. Now, a differential white blood cell count means that you're going to go and take a look at all of the cell types that are in there. So neutrophils, macrophages, lymphocytes, basophils, eosinophils, and you're going to look at what percentage of the total white blood cells do those subtypes make up. So for instance, when you do a scan of all of the white blood cells, you expect most of them are going to be neutrophils. In fact, neutrophils comprise typically 50 to 70% of the white blood cells. And lymphocytes are somewhere between 20 and 30%. Monocytes are between, 5 and 8%. Eosinophils and basophils are rare. So if you see deviations from those standard numbers, that also indicates something. For instance, if somebody has a type of lymphoma where they might have too many lymphocytes, then on a differential white blood cell count, we expect their lymphocyte percentages to be really high, like maybe 80% or 90%, rather than the typical 20 to 30%. So the total white blood cell counts are going to be done using our hemocytometers that we used last time. The counting will not be quite as laborious this time because there's not as many white blood cells. In fact, if I were to just take my blood and smear it over a hemocytometer, I would see almost all red blood cells, which is what you saw last time. So instead of diluting it out in typical saline solution, we dilute it out into what's called Turk solution. Now, Turk solution has acetic acid that lyses all of the cells, and then it stains nuclei. So what happens is all of the red blood cells are going to lyse, and all of the white blood cells are going to lyse as well, but the nuclei from each white blood cell stays intact. And so since all of the red blood cells are lysed and all that's left are nuclei, you just have to count the number of nuclei that you see, and that tells you how many white blood cells you have. All right, so what we're going to do now is switch over to the hemocytometer view and take a look at those, and you'll be responsible, just like for the red blood cells, you'll be responsible for doing your own counts. And then we'll turn and take a look at differential counts. So now what we're going to do is we're going to turn to the total white blood cell counts. To do so, we will use a hemocytometer, just like we did for Lab 15. We're loading up 10 microliters of blood on the hemocytometer. We'll go ahead and place our slide on the microscope, and let's take a look and see inside. So you'll notice right away that there's a lot fewer dots this time, and the dots that you do see are dark and small. We're going to be counting a bigger area, and I'm going to zoom in here and show you one of the four boxes that you will be counting. The blue arrows represent the boundary of one of those boxes. So you will count all of the dots that you see inside of there. And there's a lot of cellular debris, so it's important to distinguish between white blood cell nuclei and debris. In the blue arrows here, I have the white blood cells, where the debris is shown in the red arrows, so ignore the debris. Welcome back. We're going to take a look at the different types of leukocytes so that we can perform our differential white blood cell count. So this image here shows schematics or drawings of the five major leukocytes found in the blood. Unfortunately, this picture belies how difficult it can be to learn how to distinguish them, especially if you haven't done it before and you have an untrained eye. Let me show you some real cells superimposed over their drawings. So we have lymphocytes, monocytes, eosinophils, basophils, and neutrophils from left to right. And you can see that it's going to be a little more challenging to identify the various leukocytes. So there's no substitute to practice. You really just have to practice looking at cells and identifying them before your eye kind of learns what makes a lymphocyte, what makes a monocyte, etc. But I am going to give you some pointers to help you out. So first of all, you'll notice that the two images on the left, the lymphocyte and the monocyte, have cytoplasm that is clear, whereas the eosinophils, basophils, and neutrophils have cytoplasm that looks to have some granules in them. In fact, eosinophils, basophils, and neutrophils are called granulocytes because they do have these granules. So let's look at a real white blood cell smear. So you can see here where the white blood cells are versus the red blood cells. I just saw three lymphocytes go by. There's a neutrophil up at the top. Another neutrophil. Oh, another neutrophil. Lots of neutrophils. Another neutrophil. Oh, another lymphocyte. Another neutrophil. And a lymphocyte just went past. Another neutrophil. A lymphocyte. Another neutrophil. Nah, neutrophil just went past. I think I'm going back to it. There it is. Two neutrophils. And, ooh, a monocyte. Fancy. Another neutrophil. All right. In this image, I have a neutrophil up in the upper left and two monocytes on the right. Let's revisit a couple of those white blood cells and see if we can learn some tricks to identifying them. So first off, you'll see that we have lymphocytes here. There are two of them. What defines lymphocytes is that they are small and they are almost all nucleus, as you can see here. There is usually very little cytoplasm. If there is cytoplasm, it's a very minor component of the entire cell. So my rule of thumb is that if you have a small cell that is 70% or more by volume, nucleus, it's probably a lymphocyte. In our next image, we have a neutrophil on the left and two monocytes on the right. So neutrophils are by far the most common type of white blood cell that you'll see, followed by lymphocytes. And then monocytes, basophils, and eosinophils are rare. But here we got lucky and got two monocytes in the same image. So the neutrophil at the very top has a more pinkish, speckly background. The nucleus tends to be lobed, which means that it's elongated and it folds over. Very common to see a horseshoe shape or sometimes what looks like a three-leaf clover. Where the monocytes look like enlarged lymphocytes. That is, they're going to be big cells, bigger than red blood cells, usually significantly bigger. And although they don't have granules in their cytoplasm, they usually have a lot more cytoplasm than lymphocytes do. So the two on the right are monocytes, and you can tell because next to a red blood cell, they're quite large. And then here again are two neutrophils, so you can see the background is kind of speckly, so the granules are not really well defined, and the nuclei tend to be lobed or folded in some pattern. So the two we did not see on our smear were eosinophils and basophils. These are the unicorns of our leukocytes, typically the most difficult to find. In fact, it becomes something of a game when we do this in real lab, because the students all get excited when they finally find a basophil or they finally find an eosinophil. So eosinophils and basophils are also granulocytes, but unlike neutrophils, their granules are really well defined. It doesn't look speckly in the background. Rather, the cytoplasm looks like it's carrying real pebbles. So again, basophils and eosinophils, those granules are really well defined. So the difference between them is that the granules in an eosinophil stain more of a pinkish reddish color, where the granules of a basophil stain more of a dark purple or a dark blue. Now that we've finished looking at the various types of white blood cells, I'm going to turn you loose on doing your own differential white blood cell count, and good luck. My helper today in lab. Okay. I can delete all this, so I just have to start over. On the converse, we're all a little delirious here from cabin fever. On the converse, so total white blood cell counts are useful for that.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. My assistant can't handle the pressure.